We are here for the 2018 Organizational Representative PE Proposers Conference. This is a mandatory conference. If you'd like to apply for the RFP, so please make sure that you sign in now. Okay. So today we will talk about the RFP. We'll take questions, you know, after we talk about the general program. We'll talk about the quality review section, what we're looking for in the proposals. We'll take questions after that section. And then we'll talk about the application, the logistics, the links on the website, and all of those things. And then we'll take questions after that. All right, so the Organizational Representative Payee Program is paid for through Measure H special funds from the County of LA. It provides money to provide money management services at no charge to homeless or formerly homeless Social Security Administration beneficiaries in the County of Los Angeles. Eligible populations for this money is homeless or formerly homeless individuals in permanent supportive housing programs. There's approximately $1.4 million annually available. We're looking for an agency that can serve all the SPAs in the county. The contracts will start June 1st, and this is coming from County Strategy E7. Eligible applicants are any nonprofits who have already been certified through our RFSQ process. Government agencies do not need to apply through this process. The eligible activities that are funded through this program are standardized intake, assessment, and data entry, money management services, and financial independence and skill building activities. That's a pretty quick general overview. Let me know if you have any questions about that.
Sorry.
Wait for the microphone because we're recording.
Do you want to speak about
anything?
I just gave a general overview of the slides.
Well, I'll say a few more words.
Hello?
So with this, we are looking for providers that will provide representative payee services throughout the community. We're looking to fund a provider in each spot to be able to provide these services. Really, this is meant to be a program where people that are in need of representative payee services that are on Social Security can come to your program and free of cost. So this is meant to be of no charge. That's really the funding behind this is meant to pay for the services side. Yes, you can technically charge for Social Security representative payee services. However, with this program, we are asking that this is no fee to participants, that the funding from this RFP pays for those services. What we are really looking for is that, you know, you're screening and working with participants that are referred by the CES agencies within each SPA, so whatever SPA that you're bidding for, that you're making those partnerships and connections and receiving referrals from that SPA and working with those participants. You will be supporting them in their paperwork with Social Security, going into Social Security, getting the representative payee services set up. And then from there, you'll be responsible for working with the participants to create a monthly budget that identifies, you know, their rent, utilities. If they haven't moved into a place and they're still experiencing homelessness, that may be budgeting some money for the month to go towards, you know, temporary housing, whether that, you know, is, you know, they're going to go to a motel for at least a week, that there's some sort of money that's going towards permanent housing, or they're saving some money to move towards permanent housing, and then budgeting out their money for the remainder of the month for other expenses. Food, clothing are the main focuses of Social Security, and making sure that you are providing those first before they're spending money on other stuff. So each month you'll be responsible for making that budget. then your agency will be responsible for paying the rent, the utilities, and those other funds to go towards their housing, and then working with them on a schedule, depending on the person's needs, of how often they will pick up spending cash, whether it be for food, clothing, or other needs. So you'll be working with the participant and trying to set up something that meets their needs. For some participants, this may mean picking up money every other day. For others, it may mean they pick up once a week, every other week. So based upon your budget and what the person's needs are, you will work that out individually with them. Also working with that participant on financial literacy and working towards skills of managing their own money. The goal of this program is that it's not a forever program. Yes, we realize there are some people that may need representative payee services for the remainder of their life, but our goal is that the majority of them don't need representative payee services for the rest of their lives. They learn the skills to pay their own rent, to pay their utilities, to budget out their money for the month. So our goal is that participants are moving on for this program and opening up slots for new participants. So working with them around the skills to manage their own money, gain financial literacy, and moving on. Any questions then?
Coordinator here at LASA, and I'll be reviewing our quality review process for how proposals will be evaluated. As you can see, proposals will be scored by the following criteria for a total possible point value of 100. Program design at a maximum 25 points, program readiness for a maximum 25 points, past experience for 30 points, CES alignment for 10 points, and program budget cost efficiency for 10 points. For program design, your proposal should demonstrate your understanding of organizational representative payee services. In addition, your proposal should describe how you plan to communicate with your clients and how you will work to keep them involved in their financial decisions. Your proposal should also describe how the program is compliant with established organizational representative payee guidelines and SSA requirements. In addition, your proposal should include how you will promote your program services as well as how you will receive referrals. For program readiness, your proposal will be evaluated on its ability to execute the program by the contract start date of June 1st, 2018. Your proposal should include a timeline and staffing plan, and we will be assessing your organizational structure and administrative capacity to deliver services. For past experience, please make sure your proposal illustrates your experience in providing budgeting and money management services. Also, your proposal should detail your past experience in providing representative payee services through the Social Security Administration, as well as your proposal needs to include details on any financial independent skill building activities you operate for your clients. And then for CES alignment, please make sure your proposal provides details on how you, on your knowledge of the CES and how you plan to work within the system, and be sure to include how you will connect clients to services. And now I'd like to introduce Miriam Gerges, who will take care of the section on program budget.
Good morning, Miriam Gerges, Manager of Finance Programs. I'll be discussing with you guys the scoring of the proposed budget that will be included in your application. And there are four categories that your budget will be scored on. The first is leverage. Although it is not a requirement to have leverage in your proposal, you certainly score higher if you have leverage included. And if you do include leverage, you have to have documentation to support the leverage. And that that documentation can be a contract, a copy of a check, a commitment letter, or an MOU. The second part is the cost effectiveness of the program. So, for instance, an average cost per client, is it reasonable based on the services that you're providing? The fourth is accuracy. So does the budget include the required services in the RFP? And are all the costs that are included on the budget and allocated, the funding that you're requesting from WASA, are they all for eligible costs? And the fourth section is justifications, and I'll elaborate more on that part when we look at the detailed budget together. Any questions on that?
I have a couple questions, I guess, related to the program design requirements. Is that the relevant section? Great. So it references that you have to link clients to primary case management. Can we just have a little clarification on specifically what's requested and what's eligible activities for the money management case manager that can be included in the budget?
So we're looking for these programs to be linked with other services so that we're not funding this to be the primary case manager for anybody on this program. So if the person is in a permanent supportive housing or a rapid rehousing placement, that the person would be working with the case manager linked to that program. If the person is currently experiencing homelessness, that they're working with a housing navigator as they're working towards some permanent housing intervention where there would be a case manager involved. However, this is not meant to be, you know, a service that provides that full level of case management needs to anybody. It's really focused on the building financial skills, managing their money, and doing that side of it. So what's eligible is really, you know, there's a fiscal management piece of it, so building in, you know, your fiscal staff into your staffing for this, as they will be processing, you know, rent and utility payments directly to participants. So those functions actually can be written above the line into your staffing, versus typically a lot of the fiscal staff tend to be in admin for this. They are providing a service directly to that participant. So a portion of them could be billed towards this. And then staffing that meets with the participant to create the budget, if that's somebody that's different than the person that processes the checks. And then maybe the same staff that's working with the budget, maybe the same person that does financial literacy, but you could have different staff doing those different pieces. So it's really on how you want to set up your program, but really your staffing needs to be tied into how you're going to support this person in building financial skills and managing the money that they currently have.
So if they're referred to primary case management, are you requiring that they be all the way, like, to prove that they were successfully connected to primary case management elsewhere or with us?
Yes, you should be confirming that, you know, this person is linked in with some sort of case management to go forward. Typically, somebody that is in need of money management is going to be in need of some serious case management support. You shouldn't be getting a lot of people that are even in rapid rehousing. This should mostly be people that are currently in permanent supportive housing or are on the path towards permanent supportive housing. So there should be some sort of long-term linkage to case management.
Okay, and then maybe second question, it references that families have to be accepted. I guess my question is does that include just providing the rep payee service to any parent who may have minor children, or also providing the services to the children?
Yeah, you'd just be working with the parent who manages the money in the household.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm looking at this through a lens of a bank versus a credit union. And as an organization that provides payee services to individuals, I take pride in the fact that I believe that the way Housing Works provides the payee services to the individuals we serve is through that of a lens of a credit union. So my question is, how are we going to ensure, how are you going to ensure that the organization who decides to be to try to be a payee for individuals within a specific region or in a spa, for the traditional sense, historically, we have case management that has been through the traditional paradigm approach of linking and referring and not really working through an intensive case management service provision. How, what mechanisms will be put in place to measure, you know, when the case management is needed and it's not happening? How will you work with the systems in place to ensure that folks are being accountable for their role?
This is not necessarily something that's easy to answer, but as a whole, we are working on improving our working towards a active contract management model. So that's a model where we're actually on a monthly basis checking in with our different providers. So we've began on our rapid rehousing programs and are expanding outward. DHS has done a similar setup with their ICMS programs, where they are on a monthly basis kind of looking at the different data and who's being worked with and looking at case management ratios. So we are moving towards a model where we're looking at that much more actively internally here. So if you're encountering a situation, you word a bit on this, and you're encountering a situation where, hey, half the people that I'm serving are having issues with, you know, receiving services from the outside, let us know. The goal with the Measure HD7 strategy of creating additional permanent supportive housing is also to improve the current permanent supportive housing that we have. They've been in the process of looking at the different PSH that currently exists and understanding what are some of the challenges, where do we see that there's gaps, and, you know, if there's 60, 70 people in a program and yet there's only one case manager, that is a gap for permanent supportive housing, and they're looking at how they can start to potentially backfill some of those issues. So our goal, our system-wide, would be more to be like a credit union than a bank and have a higher level of, you know, customer care. So it is something that we're striving towards on a system-wide level and not just a VAG program. So if you've been on this and you are seeing issues with the people that you're enrolling not being linked to service providers, or their case managers only coming out once every 3 months, that's not something we want to see. People need to be, especially if they're on representative payee services, it's somebody that typically needs a higher level of service and therefore should be getting seen on a regular basis.
Do all referrals come through CES?
If you are currently in a program and you have participants that are in need, you can enroll, but you need to be also working with your CES leads, making sure that it's not just a program for your agency, but it's a program for that spot.
Thank you.
So, and I mean this kindly, this is probably one of the most vague RFPs I've ever seen. You guys are looking to buy something and I'm trying to figure out what it is. So as a Skid Row provider, we have, you know, 14,000 people out there on the streets. What numbers are you looking for us to serve? We obviously know we have folks within our own service level that are in need, but how do you see, what's your vision here? I'm having a hard time getting that.
So again, this is something that we have not funded in the past. This is really something new, so I will acknowledge that it maybe look a little more vague than some of our previous RFPs. They're also, it is really focused on a couple key aspects. It's not a holistic program like rapid rehousing might be. So as far as what we're looking for in, you know, people to be served, we are looking to serve as many people as possible. Again, as with all of our RFPs, if you can bring in match and leverage, you know, that's going to make your bid more competitive. As far as what our hope is, we're hoping to that, you know, across the county that we can serve somewhere between 500 to 800 people through this program. So that's our goal, but we will see what we get in, propose what you feel is reasonable and what you can actually do, and we will review the RFPs based on that. But across the county, we're looking to serve somewhere 500 to 800 people. So if you do the math, that's, you know, somewhere between around 2,000 to 3,000 per participant served.
Thanks for that clarification. I'm going to ask another, though. I've heard you say that the funds are kind of targeted to folks who would be in permanent supportive housing or on a track to be in permanent supportive housing, but I also hear you say that this is a specific niche need, right? It's to help that person who either hasn't been able to manage their finances or just got SSI or any of the other things that might have, and then put them on a trajectory to actually be able to handle that, knowing some will be able to and some won't, right? Which is the need for the service provider. So again, help me understand or paint the vision, if you will, of how LASA sees this service working in crisis and bridge housing.
So
for those people that are just getting ready to move into something that would be where they would be funding.
So there's one other program that's also being launched at the same time. Some of you in this room may be linked in with that or may not. DHS has their CBEST team. They are starting representative payee services with that program. And basically they will be serving anybody that is going through the CBEST program that needs representative payee services will be linked to a representative payee through that process. This is targeting people that are either A, already in permanent supportive housing and having issues, like, hey, they've been, you know, late or missed rent 3 times in the last year and they're at risk of, you know, losing their permanent supportive housing. So this is meant as a target for people that are already in permanent housing or for people that are in the process. They've been screened in through the CES system. You know, they're being targeted towards a permanent supportive house or permanent housing intervention. Yes, they could be in a crisis or bridge housing situation. They may be directly on the street. So the target for it is really somebody that's on their way towards permanent housing. They've been matched to a permanent housing resource. So whether we're not, you know, restricting who really gets that as far as whether they're in a crisis or bridge or transitional housing or temporary interim housing situation as they work towards it, or whether they're on the street. Obviously, it's more challenging for somebody to provide representative Payee services for somebody that's on the street versus an interim housing situation. So ideally, we'd like to get more people into interim housing, yet we realize there is going to be a need for this to serve some people that are currently street homeless. So it's a pretty wide net. It's targeting people that are already in housing that are having issues that may lose their housing, people that are working towards permanent housing. The really only subset that it's taking out is the people that are working with the CBEST providers and applying for their Social Security currently, that are working with that team. If they are receiving support and applying for their Social Security and they are identified, they will continue to work with that agency who will provide representative Payee services once they have received their benefits.
I may have misheard something. You said one per spa. There are seven spas?
Eight spas.
Serving 500 to 800 per spa?
No, total.
3,000 countywide?
No. Total. Countywide.
Oh, countywide. Okay. No.
There's not enough money to serve.
Okay, that's what I was doing. Okay, thank you.
And if we're going to serve more than one spa, do we need to do more than one application?
No, you need to be clear on what spas you are proposing to serve in your application, but you will not need to do a separate application.
A complete proposal will consist of the following: your RFP application, which will complete through MyOrg. You'll have to upload a program profile, which will complete through MyOrg as well. If you intend to subcontract, you need to complete a subcontractor program profile and upload that to FileShare. You'll also need to complete your budget template and upload that to FileShare. If it applies, please provide site control documentation and upload it to FileShare. And if you have previously been approved as an organization-representative Payee by Social Security Administration, please upload that documentation to FileShare. So the FileShare items should be uploaded into your FileShare account. Find the folder that says Funding Opportunities or New Funding Opportunities, and there will be a folder that says organization-representative Payee, and then you'll put those items in the appropriate folder. If you have any questions or any problems with your MyOrg account or uploading to FileShare, please contact our IT department. We will provide those email addresses near the end of the presentation. So I'm going to walk you through going through filling out an application. You'll need to log into your MyOrg account. So when you get to the main page, you'll sign in. And I will. So you'll sign into your MyOrg account. You go to the main page, you can access the funding opportunity page in a variety of ways, either by clicking on funding, which will take you to our funding landing page. And once you get here, you can click on the link for the RFP. In this case, it's Organization Representative Payee RFP. And once you click on that, you will come to the landing page for this RFP. It shows the timeline, RFP documents, application documents. So here you will then click on the link for the MyOrg application. Once you click on that link and you're logged into MyOrg, it will direct you to fill out an application. So start. As you fill out the application, be sure to take note of your application ID number in case you have problems with your application and you need technical assistance. You'll need to have this number to refer to. Also, if you want to go back to your application later, be sure to click the save button so you can save your work as you are completing the application. And you'll notice that it's broken down into subject titles. Your project details, be sure to complete your project name, your project address, and then here, select which service planning areas you wish to serve in this RFP. Also include your total requested funding amount for the project and the estimated number of participants you plan on serving. Please make sure that your funding amount requested matches what is listed in your budget template. And you'll also notice that the application is divided by the scoring categories. There are questions on program design, and there are questions on program readiness, your past experience, and CES alignment. Once you finish the application, please click on this button here to certify your application, and then it will be validated, and you click submit, and then it will prompt you to fill out a program profile. If you want to fill out a program profile at a later date, just go back to our homepage for the RFP and click on the Meyer program profile, and then you can be directed to filling out that section. And anything else? I will pass it off to Miriam again, who she'll walk you through how to complete your budget template.
As I mentioned before, you're required to submit a competitive budget for 12 months, and you're able to download the budget template that you'll use from this website right here. You'll click on this link. So once you click on that link right here, it'll ask you to download the budget template, and once you do that, this is what it will look like. And so the eligible activities that you will want to allocate the funding you're asking for will be over here. In this section, this is the portion that will be covered by LASA. If you have leverage or match, they'd be here. And you'll need to submit the documentation on FileShare for those to support it. And this is, it'll total up here, auto total for you, for the total program budget. You'll also need to provide justifications for the cost that you're listing on your detailed budget. So that'll be right here on the right hand side. I think that about covers the budget portion. Does anybody have questions on this particular part?
In terms of documenting leverage, I didn't see that in the RFP, but also if it's if we were leveraging a staff member's time who was funded through either general fund or another source, what specific documentation would you be looking to see?
Go ahead and get that information for you. I'll reach out to our monitoring and compliance and get that answer for you.
Thank you.
But just if the appropriate documentation for leverage could include a contract, a copy of a check, a commitment letter, or an MOU. But I'll ask specifically about that case for you. So here's the timeline. You are now at the mandatory proposers conference. If you think of any questions after today, you have until February 26th at 2 p.m. to email any questions. We'll publish the unanswered question from today, as well as any questions and answers that you send in. Our team is not able to answer any questions outside of this email process. We publish all the questions and answers so everyone has the same information. Like Elsie said before, if you have any issues with the application or the links online, please contact our IT department. The deadline for the submission is March 16th at 2 p.m. We will do the quality review during the month of April, and contracts are expected to start June 1st. In your PowerPoint, we provided links to the documents we went over today. There's also the email for the IT department. This is the end of our presentation. Are there any final questions?
Thank you. Regarding the previously approved organizational payee with SSA, this would be a new endeavor and service that we would like to provide to our clients. I have no idea what the timeline is to get approved. Is that contingent or anything to do with being able to go forward with this application process if we're getting approved for that simultaneously?
So it is not a requirement. We encourage you to reach out and look into what all the process is. However, getting approved as a rep paid entity is actually pretty straightforward and easy, easier than you think it would be. So really, once, if you are approved and you haven't been an organizational payee before, really that goes into past experience and program readiness. And if you've already done it, got some past experience, you're ready to have the program start. But if you haven't and you're awarded, once you have a participant that has Social Security benefits and is in need of the representative pay services, you will go into Social Security for the first time, and it's a matter of meeting with the representative there and saying, I want to become a representative payee, and they will walk you through the process. It depends by each region how quickly that all takes, but in conversations with the Social Security Administration, it shouldn't take very long. As another part of that, you will need to have $2,000 in bonding for each participant that you're serving. So if you plan to serve 100 participants, you would need a bond for this for $200,000. So just in preparing for this program, to keep that in mind, and that Social Security, as taking on more people, will look at what you're bonded for. But the process of becoming a rep payee is pretty straightforward once you go in with a participant, but you will need a participant before, if you're not currently a representative payee program, you will need a participant before you can become a
The contract start date is June 1. I thought it said there was a 60-day period for startup.
So your contract will begin June 1. With that, you can start expending funds. Your actual outcomes and targets, we don't look at starting that until 60 days in. So you could, if you're ready, start providing services right away. But as far as how we look at your program, as far as outcomes and that, we won't look at until 60 days in. But you could start just expend funds right away.
Okay, any last questions? All right. I'll be sure to sign it. Thank you very much.